So we are perfectly on time. So I suggest that we get this wonderful event started. And I will now hand in the mic to my co-founder, Colomb, for a quick introduction, and then we'll jump straight into this discussion with our guest.
Perfect. Hi, everyone. My name is Colomb. I'm thrilled to be hosting this virtual town hall. Thank you for joining us today. Today is a very special day. We'll talk about the Tiananmen massacre and the need to remember. Today is the 32nd anniversary of the Tiananmen massacre. 32 years ago, the Chinese army moved on students who were peacefully gathering in the symbolic Tiananmen Square in Beijing. And today I'm very, very honored to be joined not only by my co-founder Andrea, but also by Wang Chaohua, who was a student leader in the Tiananmen Square protest. And please correct me if I mispronounce your name. I'm trying my best. I asked people and checked on Google. Okay, perfect. And by Sheng, who is a human rights activist, a poet, a journalist, and who every year organizes Tiananmen commemoration in Canada. And we invited the both of them today to one, remember, hear from them, hear about their experience, and hear about what hope we have for the future coming from some of the people who directly try to seek democracy and freedom across the world. A last point of order before we start hearing from you and asking you a lot of questions. We are recording this webinar. To the attendees, please ask all of your questions in the Q&A or in the comments. We'll try to ask all of them. We are also live streaming on Facebook. Please send us all of your questions, your comments, your kind words, we'll proceed. But Andrea, I'll leave you the mic.
Thank you so much, Colin, for this intro. So I would kickstart this conversation in a very simple way. I think the best way to understand the history behind today's commemoration is to hear, obviously, from our guests. So I don't know who wants to begin. I can start with Mrs. Sheng, since she was in the call first, to maybe briefly present your experience, why you commemorate every year, and obviously tell us more about the events of 1989. Because many of our young attendees have only read about that, but did not witness the unfolding of the terrible events of that year.
Thank you very much. Yes, I have been organizing the commemorations events in Toronto, and not only in Toronto, Canada, for the past 31 years. Not a single one was missed. And every time people may ask, why do you do this? Why do you continually for 30 some years to do the same thing? It's very simple. And I was a survivor of the massacre. I have to speak out for those who have been silenced. And also, I deeply feel that I have this kind of responsibility, especially to tell the world what happened. And even more important is that I never think about the massacre was stopped from that year, from a few days after the June 4th. Actually, the massacre has continued until today. But of course, it may be in different form. And I was waiting for my student visa during that period of time at home to come to Canada. So I had time to go to Tiananmen Square every day. And my home was very close to Tiananmen Square, about 700 meters to the southeast corner of the square. And also I pay very close attention to this kind of social science for many years when I was very young. So when this movement started, I was so much encouraged. And I hoped that was the chance, the very big chance to change China. And I saw people's hope too. Most people were hoping that was a chance to change the system, the political system in China, even though many people still review as the majority of the student, they didn't ask for the political system's change, and they only asked to stop the corruption. But when the movement was started, and it wasn't only the students, it was joined by millions of residents, not only in Beijing, but nationwide. And many people were pretty clear about the goal, and as well as myself. And, you know, 32 years have been passed. I think still many people won't believe that the Chinese regime could use troops, tanks, machine guns to deal with this peaceful democracy movement. And yes, they did. And there's so much we still don't know. So why I call this as massacre has never been stopped? Because everything remained the same or even much, much worse. No one could publicly to commemorate of this tragedy in China. And even those people who died, their loved ones. And it's like slower murdering to those people who loved their sons or their parents or their relatives. And so every time when I organize the event here, it makes me look back to that moment. And I wrote some articles, but most are in Chinese. And you know, the most important part was I went out to streets in the evening of June 3rd. And because I lived very close to Tiananmen Square, and so I was stopped in front of the Beijing Public Security Bureau, Beijing Gong'anju. And at there, I joined people to try to stop the military vehicles because the armed vehicle were passing by the street from there. And we dig the brick from the ground. It's a 9 square brick, and to smash them into small pieces. And we pick the piece and to throw to the armed vehicles. And even some people, they have the empty bottle and to put in a little bit of gasoline and to have a paper to light it in fire and throw to the armed vehicle. During that period of time, I even didn't feel scared because people joined together and tried to stop the army. And then about 3:30, we heard the gunshots. And at the beginning, some people even didn't believe that was the sounds from gunshots. And people said, oh, it's a fireworks. And must be the victory of the students at the Tiananmen Square. But when we listened to it carefully, and also then we saw You know, this tricycle, we call it a sanlunche, they have bodies and injured students rushing from the square to hospital. Then we realized that it was the military open fire. So people, the gathering was disappeared and I went back to home, but I couldn't sleep. I couldn't stay at home. And then I came out again from home. I want to go to Tiananmen Square because in the evening of June 3rd, I wanted to go to Tiananmen Square and I was stopped. So I said, I have to go to the square. I want to know what happened there. About 5:30, I came out again and I was with a friend, my girlfriend, and we rushed to the southeast corner outside the square. At that moment, I was thinking, you know, why the United Nations don't send the peacekeeper to Beijing? Because it was like a real war. The tanks occupied all the squares and we could see from this angle, from this corner. And at there, the soldier in front of us on the other side of the street, we were standing on the south side, the soldiers line up on the north side and suddenly opened fire to us. People were fall on the ground because it wasn't time for people to run. And the very moment when it's calm and I left my head from the ground to see the soldier, I still remember the very clean, calm face and holding the gun pointed to us. It's been 32 years. And the massacre never stopped. No one could openly to talk about the massacre. That is the most tragic is, and no one could talk about that tragic. And also, you know, people who participated with that movement either died, been silenced forever, or in exile, or they shut up, or they cooperate with the tyranny. So not even one person is free from the massacre today. And also, look at those people who died, who lost their children or who lost their parents. They are in this kind of situation for 32 years. And the massacre actually like a slower murdering, you know, to bed them piece by piece. And look at today's China. Besides the tyranny has been much, much more stronger and richer, and yeah. Nothing is better. Nothing else is better. And the whole world gave up to boycotting the tyranny soon after the massacre and decided to help Chinese government to develop and to grow stronger. And then had to buy, had to have this kind of trade and deal with them and to buy technology from them and let them to control us. And the very sad result is today the whole world has been so much suffering from the China, from the CCP's virus today.
Thank you for sharing this. I just want to jump as well, because we're getting quite a lot of questions. So thank you for sharing so much and for being so open about your experience. I cannot even imagine how traumatic it must still be 32 years later. But we're very grateful that you can speak about it so openly. Ms. Wang, we're getting quite a lot of questions for you as well. And I mean, a lot of us have read so much about you prior to that, how you were one of the leaders of the Tiananmen Square protest, how you got involved as a student. And one of our attendees...
No, I'm sorry, I wasn't a student.
No, I'm talking, sorry, to Ms. Wang.
Oh, okay.
And I was, one of our attendees is asking if you share a similar experience and how you got involved with the student protest in the first place.
Right. I think to understand the China in the 1980s, you have to know it was the first decade of reform after the Mao's Cultural Revolution. So there was a sense of opening up, and we would get opportunities so long as we can keep this direction. But apparently, once the former party secretary general Hu Yaobang was removed in 1987 due to his support to student democratic demands for general election of local people's representative, the students had started feeling very depressed, and they had this pending discontent, which went to the beginning of 1989, when even the party was preparing a commemoration of the 70th anniversary of 1919's May 4th movement, which was the catalyst of the setting up of the party. You see, 1919 May 4th was 2 years before 1921. That's what the party now is preparing to celebrate its centennial this year, right? So students had the sense, very strong sense, this is the 70th anniversary of May 4th student movement. That was the topmost important event in modern Chinese history. And this is 40th anniversary of PRC's setting up. And students were quite conscious that it was also the 200th anniversary of French Revolution. So we got to speak out. And it so happened, this removed the party secretary general Hu Yaobang died on April 15, that was the beginning of our protest. And I was on the square when Hu Yaobang's funeral, official funeral was held. Students demanded participation. We had about 100,000 students in the square, but the government didn't allow students to get in. From that day on to the opening fire by the army against the protesters, it was almost 60 days. Okay. For about 20 years, we were able to claim we were the longest mass protest and the most peaceful urban protest, and by the end we were crushed by military force. The record was broken by students and the protesters in Hong Kong in 2014. Their occupy lasted 78 days, and further the record broken in Hong Kong in 2019, where their protest lasted almost half a year. What Beijing regime has learned was in 1989, they sent in direct the formal army defense force with tanks, with machine guns. Now they learned to kill you by slow bleeding, as they are doing to Hong Kong people. Hong Kong has been the place commemorating Tiananmen every year. Every year, by the time of June 5th, you could see on the front page, on the front website page, our printed version, Hong Kong has a sea of candles. Last year, it was canceled by the authorities under the excuse of the pandemic. And this year, even if the pandemic was controlled relatively well in Hong Kong, they canceled it again. At this moment, my friends sent in photos and clips. Police, Hong Kong authorities prepared 7,000 police to stop people from going into Victoria Park. So people were asking, will June 4th become a sensitive word in Hong Kong again? This is what many of our friends have lived under pressure, under shame in the mainland China, as in particular, the Tiananmen mother group. When talking about the Tiananmen protest, I think we have three images instantly coming up. I believe many people, even younger generation around the world would know that. First would be those young protesters died, shot dead or rolled over by tanks. One of them was a 17-year-old high school student who was, due to parental concern, was locked into the small restroom at their family flat. He managed to got out to get out from the window and rushed to the Chang'an Avenue leading to the square and shot there. His mother was the leading figure of the Tiananmen mothers group. They gathered more than 200 members. Now, about 60 of them have passed away in the past 30 years. I think all of you could see my hair has turned peppery. It's over 30 years. The youngest of my comrade fighting there, army in arms in 1989, now about 50. These parents who lost their children, they were waiting for the day justice will come to them. The second image would be the tank man, a single boy, single man leading, holding some shopping bags, standing in front of row of tanks. That is, I would tell you, only one of thousands heroic Beijing citizens, Beijing residents that evening. That's why the army took several hours before overcoming about 2 kilometers distance to reach the square. The third, I think, is what Sheng Xue just mentioned, the rows of tanks stationed in the square next day as if showing their victory, the tyrannous victory over the masses. I think the whole world shouldn't forget. The memory, of course, is my personal, and it's a personal memory to the mother of that young high school student, but it's a public memory. Public, important for the whole nation of the Chinese people and for the whole world. No one should forget. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Wang. I mean, also thank you, Mrs. Sheng. I mean, these accounts are incredibly important. And I think the fact that we're recording them, we're streaming them, they will stay, they will remain in front of the eyes of many, many young people, which hopefully will be able to, you know, pick up this testimony and continue the struggle for many decades to come until we succeed, until freedom prevails. I want just to ask you a follow-up question, Mrs. Wang, and then we'll move back to Mrs. Sheng. I remember, if I read correctly, that you were one of the student leaders that negotiated with the Chinese, or tried to negotiate with the Chinese government ahead of the massacre. Can you tell us a bit more about what went on in that moment, and why did you take this choice or this strategy to try to win over the situation?
It was kind of a reason with the government as they tried to pacify the protest. And for the second week of May, after we had our own march on May 4th in commemoration, as I mentioned, then there was a relatively some period of lull, so things were quieter, and the government stepped up there suddenly. So you go back to check the newspapers those days, the People's Daily was about reporting every day. This premier had held a dialogue with workers from here. That party secretary had a dialogue with school teachers there. So we had the sense of if we were, sidelined, although we had organized a million people demonstrations, the government didn't want to talk to us. So we organized a dialogue delegation and they demanded that you should talk to the protesters. It's as if fighting to see who is representing the voice of the masses. The party, no matter what, even today, they always say they represent the Chinese people. You have a People's Liberation Army, you have a People's Court, you have a National People's Congress, everything, they hold this word loud and they repeat it. But when you had all these people protesting and we got support from all walks of the society, they didn't want to talk to you until a group of very advantageous students, very daring students, started a hunger strike. It was very much like in 2014 in Hong Kong, when all these protesters were frustrated that Beijing wouldn't listen to their proposals for further legal reform. Then Joshua Wang jumped over the fence to occupy the citizens' square in front of the legal, that's Hong Kong's legislative council. Then their Occupy movement all of a sudden started because Joshua Wang then was taken away. That's similar to hunger strike started. The government officials rushed to find the young intellectuals, asking, do you know those students? Can you find the student leaders? We would like to talk to them. So there we had a chance.
Thank you. To both of you, I mean, we're getting a lot of questions. I'm going to try to get to all of them. One of the questions we get at every event similar to this one is, how can people help? And let me qualify this. Ms. Sheng, you organize every year commemoration events. You are both very outspoken and have done a lot of work for the duty to remember and for the need for people to know what has happened. What do you think, one, the Chinese diaspora in exile should and can do to support the freedom and democratic movements? And second, what should, normal people like myself across the world do to support your work? And I'll start with Ms. Chang first, since you didn't speak for a while.
Thank you. Actually, the first time when I participating in organized the event in 1990, and I was pretty, actually, I never imagined that 32 years after is still the same. No. And I think most people won't think that it can take for 32 years. And yes, I just talked a little bit about the Western world. And when they give up to boycotting the Chinese regime, that the result is, as Chaohua just mentioned, the massacre is happening in Hong Kong. And actually, the massacre was already launched in place in Tibet before the Tiananmen massacre. That we need to remember that too. So the situation in China has been lasting for 72 years, and it's never changed. So when we talk about the 89th movement, and when we talk about the June 4th massacre, the Tiananmen massacre, and we need to know that wasn't the only one incident. That wasn't the only one massacre and the tragedy in Chinese history. No, it was a chain of countless massacres, big and small, or, you know, is lasting until today, and in Tibet too, and the concentration camp. So, like 10 years ago, maybe people don't think that the Chinese government would do this to Uyghurs, to the Muslims, to have concentration camp, to, you know, to block in 3 million people there. But I don't, you know, it's not surprising me, because I followed this role, and I think I am one of not many people to understood the nature of the Chinese regime, the CCP regime, from very since I was young. And even when the Chinese regime opened fire to people in 1989, I wasn't too shocked. And because I learned about this information even before that. So when we talk about the things happening in China, we really need to look at it in a bigger picture, that what we can do, what we should do, and what especially the whole world need to do. And the situation in abroad, I mean, out of China, even getting worse and worse. I think Chaohua will agree with me in this point too, because when I, you know, organizing this event in 1990, we had 40,000 of people to join us. And then 7,000, 3,000, and a few hundreds, and a few hundreds, lasting until now. And people are much, much more fear and frightened to participate in this kind of event in democratic countries. Why? Because everybody knows that the Chinese communist regime, they have their hands, they have their eyes, they have their ears, they have their power, their network, their technology, everything in our country. Canada, United States, Australia, European country, everywhere. So everybody knows this and makes this, you know, this kind of even the commemoration event is very hard to organize. You need to make many phone calls to ask people if you could come, if you could participate, and they will give you, you know, countless reasons for why they cannot come. Actually, one reason is enough. So what we can do, and so that's why I really think the whole world should take the responsibility, you know, not to help the Chinese regime, but to help the Chinese people to realize democracy and freedom in China and to freedom. And especially when the Chinese regime is launching the war now to everybody, to the world, I mean the CCP virus, no one except from this war now, we should take that really seriously and to hold the Chinese government accountable. That we, everybody can do, should do, must do.
Thank you for this. Ms. Wang, what do you think? How do you think the world, and by the world, I mean people, Chinese and non-Chinese, can support? And I see that Zoe in the chat say, or asked you, do you think dialogue with the CCP will still work? And I think she's referring to what you told us before.
No.
Sorry, I added something. In 1995 and 1996, because I am in Canada, that Canadian government said that we will have a dialogue instead of confrontation with China. From there and to now, look at the change of the world. So dialogue with evil won't work at all.
I'm still asking the question as it was asked, and you mentioned that you had a dialogue before. You tried to increase the dialogue during the Tiananmen Square protest. So do you think that this could work, Ms. Chang and Ms. Wang, sorry, and what else should we do?
I think the question of a dialogue means that you have two parties. And so we are talking about who would be the other party aside from the Communist Party. Okay, your dialogue with the Chinese government, you pursue dialogue with the Chinese government. Essentially, you're having dialogue with the party. So basically, the party wouldn't allow you if you are a mass organization. This happened to us. So they never satisfy the hunger strikers' demand to have a direct televised dialogue. They fear they would lose their pedigree in front of the whole nation. So they didn't want to lose their power. And it happened again with people in Hong Kong. So these people, under their rule, they wouldn't grant you equal dialogue. However, as for foreign government, I think it's important to keep on dialogue because that's a way to keep China on check. At the same time, dialogue alone would never work. The citizens of foreign countries must stand up. For more than 30 years, how the Beijing regime controlled all this national memory of more than a billion people about Tiananmen, it was a very heavy-handed censorship and the speech control backed by police force. You spoke about it, you could be visited by police, particularly now with internet police, instantly within an hour, and you would be taken away. And your parents, your family members would be all in trouble. This is not, this kind of situation is not unique to the Chinese, because Beijing is pushing it over people from other countries, along with its growing economic power think about this manager of the basketball team, Rocket from Houston, because he supported Hong Kong protesters. The whole NBA was boycotted. So NBA members could feel they must protest in the US, giving the knee to support Black Lives Matter. They could not support Hong Kong protesters, even by speaking out on Twitter. The whole NBA then was kind of put down. So everything you must recognize, your freedom of speech now is facing censorship from China. All these textile companies got into trouble because they couldn't send freely inspectors to check if there would be forced labor in Xinjiang cotton producing areas. It's not that all these companies say, yes, there are forced laborers, but the Beijing wouldn't allow you to inspect. So they start, because they sent the agreement rejecting forced labor, without inspection, they cannot. So they stopped petition from Xinjiang, Uyghur area. Because of this, Beijing started boycotting all of these companies. They are all under pressure. We should support them. We should support because Beijing is pushing it, censorship over free speech on every of us, over every citizens around the world, no matter you are living in a democracy, under a democracy, or a semi-democracy, or whichever third world countries. No talk about Tibet, no talk about Tiananmen, no talk about Taiwan, this is so-called 3T, and now no talk about the Uyghurs. We cannot accept this. You walk to, as a tourist, you walk through the border check into China, you should say, I want to return my rights as a free individual.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Wang. Very powerful. And thank you, Mrs. Sheng. I mean, for everyone listening, it's incredibly powerful to hear these stories. And we saw, I mean, as a European, not an American, but we saw the hypocrisy of, for example, NBA player were completely shut off from the Hong Kong situation, but also actors. I remember John Cena just a few days ago, he basically apologized for calling Taiwan a country. So not even for attacking the regime, but just for stating something that should be public knowledge right now. So we completely understand it's something we're fighting every day, but it's today our governments and our celebrities are very scared about consequences, and it's very worrying.
Yeah, if I may add, so we should give a thumb up to Lady Gaga. She supported Dalai Lama, and then they canceled her concert in Shanghai, and she stopped going.
Yeah, these are exactly the kind of behavior we should support with all our strength. So thank you for reminding us.
And then let's just give a little shout out to Lady Gaga as a result and push everyone to listen to more of her music.
Exactly. And Colombe, you were mentioning some questions that you wanted to pick from the chat. I don't know if you have one in particular.
So we have quite a lot of questions. I just wanted to tell you that, for example, Mauro is telling you, thank you for this amazing discussion. He was going to ask a question, but sometimes it's just better to listen and learn for people who have suffered and experience in the front line. And we also just got one from John. John says, China has a millennia of autocratic political rule, different from the West and our roots in Greek democracy. What would it be helpful for us in the West to know more about from Chinese history and culture to help inform how to move forward today? I don't know if any of you want to answer this. I thought it was an interesting take.
Yes, I'll try first about the dialogue. I believe because the Chinese economy now is permitting into, due to this globalization, into national economies all around the world, into many other countries. So government should keep the channel open. And also because China is one of the permanent Security Council member of the five. So it's a big power club there. It's something like on the government level, it's also important to keep dialogue with Putin in Russia. That said, the most important thing is as citizens, we should keep on pressure our own government, not to be soft-kneed, not to be giving in at a principle over principle matters. And also we'll show our own bottom line, not to give up, not to give in. Second, about this, I don't, a cultural thing, I do not believe this cultural essentialism. All the different cultures in the past 500 years, 300 years, went through modernization. And the democracy, modern democracy didn't come to the world automatically, as if only to the Western countries. In the Chinese cultural sphere, we have Taiwan, vibrant, lively democracy. It's not that the Chinese people could not handle democracy. It's mainly the Communist Party in Beijing.
Yes, and even though there are many different political forms, and even for democracy, there are many different forms. Canada is different from United States, right? Taiwan is different from us, but two people, there are only, in general, it's only two kinds of political system and two kinds of governments. If the government gives service to people, or the government take rights from people, or the government to obey people, or people have to obey the government. So it's very clear. And when people talk about so kind of the culture, the history, the different lifestyle, is not the political system. And the political system is a very clear democracy or the dictatorship.
Thank you so much. And I mean, you're speaking to the right crowd, because as a movement with, like, we have people from all over the planet, and we completely believe that at the end, we have our beautiful differences, cultural differences and so on. But at the end, if you believe in freedom and democracy, the line to take is very clear, right? It's not, you can't take away rights. People should be able to decide their own future, elect their own leaders. And so we are all in this together. But thank you so much for addressing this very important question from John. We're in the last 10 minutes of the events. And so I would like to ask to turn the conversation a bit towards the future. I mean, the past is very dark, and still nowadays, sadly, the fight is very long. But what I would like to ask for you is, what's your hope for the freedom, for the future of democracy in China, if there is any? Maybe Mrs. Sheng can start. Can you share a bit your vision for the struggle for the future?
Yes, of course. Freedom and democracy will be realized in China, that's for sure. And the problem is that how much cost we have to pay, and how long time we have to wait, and how many lives we have to lost, that is the question. And so that's, I always think that everybody has the responsibility to join together, fight for this goal. And especially for people who is enjoying freedom and democracy, because those people have a much more chance. For people in China now, it's very much limited because it's even much more worse than a few years ago. And I have a friend who was released from prison and he wanted to visit his friend who was in the same prison. And when he just checked the train ticket on his cell phone, and he received a phone call from police officer, don't go anywhere, okay? This is the reality in China. You cannot do anything if you have been already targeted, or you cannot do anything if even you think you are free, but they have the technology to check on everybody's. And even here, even our life in Canada, European countries, United States, whatever. So we must unite and to end the tyranny, the Chinese tyranny, as soon as possible. Of course, there are other tyrannies in the world, but the Chinese tyranny is the biggest and the strongest, the richest, and the most evil one. I always believe in this, and we need to work together. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Sheng. Mrs. Wang, do you want to also?
Thank you for asking about this. I hope one day democracy will come to China and will really take roots and growing into a stable political system benefiting all citizens living in that land. But I recognize, firstly, it's a very difficult process. Looking at what is going on in Myanmar, we can see there could be a path of a zigzag going forward, two steps forward, one step back, or one step forward, two step back. So we have to be prepared and recognize there could be many, many problems. So that said, I also feel encouraged by the younger generations in China who are showing greater and greater awareness about individual rights. If you ask young Chinese woman about Me Too movement or women's rights, you could see the general reaction would be very different from 30 years ago. And it's really widespread, not only for the urban white collar workers, but also for the migrant workers from countries that really low income. And then now you see when economic situation wasn't so brilliant and the great number of labor force started voicing their frustration, their discontent, their demand, it's not in the form of political demands yet, but I think there I really see widespread self this consciousness about citizens' rights. So all talking about the government's dialogue about citizens of foreign countries, how to help, I also encourage, I would, if you may, keep on your contact with your Chinese friends or make new friends with Chinese people. Communication, making friends, that's important.
Thank you very much for this. What you said both really resonated, and when you talked about Myanmar, you know, there's so many struggles for democracy across the world, and we see that, I say this every time, but democracy is never won, it always remains to be won. there's always some backsliding. We see this even in established democratic system, and then there's huge roads ahead to be traveled in authoritarian countries. And I do think that looking at how the world is working, and you mentioned it with, you know, making new friends and communicating, we have the potential to unite and to work together across borders to support one another, to find new tactics, new solutions, and to make sure that, you know, we say it clearly and we say it loudly that we won't stand down and that we will remember and that we will work together as one. So thank you both for joining us today. Thank you for making the time. And we will continue to spread, or try the best we can to spread the word about Tiananmen Square and what happened. It is fundamental for new generations to learn about it and for this not to be another casualty of the Chinese government that is just forgotten. And we will continue to unite beyond borders.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you so much. I just want to send a final message as well to the listeners. We are our organization now is going to hold a protest or commemoration at 5 p.m. in London in front of the Chinese embassy. And I'm sure that wherever you are in the world, there are commemorations. So if you can, please attend, please show support. Whether you are Chinese or not, it doesn't matter, but showing up, commemorating the massacre, ensuring that there are still people standing up against dictatorship is truly important.
It starts at 8 o'clock in the evening in London, yes.
Perfect. So join all the protests. Mrs. Sheng and Mrs. Wang will be, I'm sure, on the front line, wherever they are in the world. And together we are stronger. So thank you so much for joining, and let's commemorate this special day together. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.